Sometimes you can easily spot the aura of a pole, and sometimes this is more difficult. And it is in a certain sense not that bad if you misjudge the aura of a pole when you're computing the residue. If you have a lower order in mind than the true order, you will get infinity for your residue, so you know you did something wrong, and you can correct this. If you have a higher order in mind than the true order, you will find the correct residue. You are only doing some unnecessary differentiations. However, especially this latter, the latter of course can be a lot of work, so you want to avoid it. So we would like to be able to find the correct order in of a pole, and that's what you will learn in this video. For that, we first look at the order of a zero of a function. It's similar to what you learned for single variable calculus. Suppose f of z is analytic, and then f of z is said to have a zero of order m at z zero. Well, if it's say m times zero, if f and f prime and f double and f triple, etc., till the m minus one derivative, they all have to be zero at z zero, and the next term is non-zero, then you say that f of z has a zero of order m. And in that case, you can write f of z as z minus z0 to the power m times some g of z. G of z is again analytic, but now g of z0 is not equal to 0. So, let's do an example. F of z equals z squared minus 1 and z0 equals 1. Well, if you plug in 1, you get 0. So 1 is a 0 of f of which order? Well, we have f of 1 equals 0, f prime equals 2z. If you plug in 1, we get f prime of 1 equals 2. It's not equal to 0, so only f is 0, not its derivative. So we have a 0 of order 1 in 1. And you can write f as z minus 1 times z plus 1, so as z minus 1, in which we see where the 0 is, times some g of z, where g of z is not equal to 0 at 1. So you can always factor out this part with the zeros in your f. And that's what you use. Suppose we have p and q both analytic. P of z 0 is not equal to 0, so your numerator, f will be p over q, so your numerator is not equal to 0, and your denominator is 0 at z 0 and has a 0 of order m. Then your quotient, so this part is not 0 and this part has a 0 of order m, then your quotient has a pole of order m. Now, why is that? Well, your f equals p over q, and your q can be written as z minus z0 to the power m times some analytic g, which is not equal to 0. Then your f equals phi, where phi equals p over g, times 1 over z minus z0 to the power m, and your phi is analytic because p was already analytic. Your g is analytic because it's not 0, and it's not 0, so the quotient is analytic. And furthermore, phi of z0 is not equal to 0 because p was not 0 there. So you can write your f as phi over z minus z0 to the power m, and you recognize that it has a pole of order m. So, for example, if you have f of z equals 1 over 1 minus cosine z, well, if you plug in 0 in the cosine, you get 1 minus 1 equals 0. So your denominator becomes 0. Well, what's the order of the 0 of 1 minus cosine z? Well, if you plug in 0, you get 0. Derivative of 1 minus cosine z equals minus sine. If you plug in 0, you get again 0. And if you differentiate again, you get minus a cosine. Plug in 0, you get a minus 1. So the second derivative is not 0. So z equals 0 is a 0 of order 2 of 1 minus cosine z. We have a function 1 over 1 minus cosine z. Numerator is not 0, of course, it's just 1. You divide by a function which has a 0 of order 2, which means this function f of z has a pole of order 2, z0. So what happens if your numerator is 0 at your z0? So again, p and z analytic. Now, suppose your p of z0 equals 0, has a 0 of order n, and let's assume that it's smaller than the m order of the 0 of Q. So numerator 0 of order N and the denominator 0 of order M, where the M is higher than the N. And then the quotient has a pole for the M minus N. Now, why is that? Well, you can write your F equals P over Q as set minus at 0 to the power N divided times G1 times, divided by set minus at 0 to the power M times from G2. And you're left with some phi offset divided by set minus at 0 to the power M minus N. So an analytic function divided by a power of set minus at 0. So, for example, if you have a similar function to your example 2, if you have sine z over 1 minus cosine z, now if you plug in z equals 0 to the numerator, you get 0. So what's the order of the 0 of the numerator? Well, you plug in 0, you get 0, but the derivative of sine equals the cosine, plug in 0, you get 1. So the 0 is a 0 of order 1 at the numerator of order 2 at the denominator. So z equals 0 will be a pole of order 1 of this function f of z. So this is how you can always figure out what the order of a pole is. Look at the order of the 0 of the numerator, look at the order of the 0 of the denominator. If the order of the 0 of the numerator is bigger than the order of the 0 of the denominator, you will have a removable singularity, so you don't have to worry. If the order of the 0 of the denominator is higher than the order of the 0 of the numerator, then the order of your pole is just the m minus n, the order of the 0 of the numerator minus the order of the 0 of the denominator. So this is how you can find the order of all your poles.